Welcome to our worship on this Sunday, the 21st of March 2021, as we mark the beginning of Passiontide. And we begin this morning with our first hymn, sung for us by Huddersfield Choral Society. Father, we love you. Our worship this morning is a service of Holy Communion, and those of you who are used to participating in this from home, please do have your wine and your bread or whatever you wish to use in front of you. So when we come to receive our communion, you too may receive your representation of the body and blood of Christ at the same time. And our service this morning is being led for us by myself, Reverend Michelle Goodrich, here at St. Mary's. Our intercessions are by Reverend Graham Joyce, and our sermon will be with Father John Gleaves, who is also working in the technical booth this morning and involved with Brian Haley in the recording of this service. And so let us have a moment of silence as we bring our concerns before God and lay all that we are at the foot of His cross. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and also with you. And so we say together our prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen. Lord, have mercy. And God shows his love for us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Let us then show our love for him by confessing our sins in penitence and faith. And we unite together in our words of confession. O God, you know our foolishness, and our sins are not hidden from you. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Let not the flood overwhelm us, nor the depths swallow us up. Let not the pit shut its mouth upon us. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Hear us, O Lord, as your loving kindness is good. Turn to us as your compassion is great. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May God, who loved the world so much that he sent his Son to be our Saviour, forgive us our sins and make us holy to serve him in the world, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And our prayer for this week, for the fifth Sunday of Lent. Most merciful God, who by the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, delivered and saved the world, grant that by faith in him who suffered on the cross, we may triumph in the power of his victory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. I invite Reverend Graham to come and read for us our first Bible passage.
Reading from the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 5 and verse 5. So also Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, "You are my son, today I have begotten you." As he also says in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. About this we have much to say that is hard to explain, since you have become dull in understanding. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic elements of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food. For everyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is unskilled in the word of righteousness. But solid food is for the mature, for those whose faculties have been trained by practice to distinguish good from evil. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our second hymn this morning, sung by the St. Michael's Singers, is Meekness and Majesty.
Would you please stand? Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honour. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour. No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, an angel has spoken to him. Jesus answered, this voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. May the words of our lips and the thoughts and meditations of all our hearts be now and always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and Redeemer. Amen. Do please be seated. How often have we seen a job position advertised and decided to apply for it? To me, it seems that some people make a regular habit of so doing. Perhaps they enjoy being interviewed. Others, though, like me, not so frequently. But if we do decide to apply for the post which is advertised, we fill out the form on which we gave details of our person, then fill in our qualifications, followed by our work and professional details, almost as filling in the census form, which we should be doing today. In that process, we also nominate three referees who, if asked, send us a reference character for us. Having filled in the details, we send off the application form together with a covering letter. Then we wait, and we wait. Perhaps two or even maybe 3 weeks later, a letter arrives telling us to attend for interview at a certain time, at a certain place, on a certain day. Upon receiving this invitation, we may have a feeling of elation. However, as the appointed day and time gets closer, we begin to think about what questions we may be asked and what will happen. How have the referees rated me, we perhaps think. Perhaps we may think, oh, I'll just be my usual self for the interview. And the interviewing panel, which is normally made up of 3, 4, 5, or even 6 persons, wish to see how we respond to them. During this time too, they build up a picture of us, which enables them to see who will be most suitable person for the position. Perhaps we're asked to give a presentation just to reinforce that fact. Sorry, turned over 2 pages. Just to reinforce that fact, to show that we are prepared to do the work for which we may be appointed. The panel is collectively building up an image of us. They are seeing us at only that moment in time. During his ministry, our Lord had many interviews. Not only friendly interviews, but mainly hostile ones. Those who posed the hostile questions had already made up their minds about Jesus. He was not obeying the Judaic teachings as such. And many people adopted this attitude. Their complete status was being questioned by this wandering preacher. How dare he suggest we were doing wrong? Many, though, had their doubts about Jesus, but were not hostile towards him, really. For example, John the Baptist was in prison, whence he sent 2 disciples to ask, "Are you he who would come, or do we have to look for another?" Jesus answered the question not with a direct answer, but indirectly. And he said to them, that is, to the disciples, "Go and tell John what you have seen and heard. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, the poor have good news preached to them, and blessed is he who takes no offence at me." Indeed, such an answer would leave people rather perplexed and nonplussed. What sort of an answer is that, we may think, if we were on the receiving end? It was a "make up your mind about me" answer. As we are looking at Jesus' indirect answers, we recall his meeting with a Samaritan woman. Jesus had arrived at Jacob's well, and a little weary as the day wore on, he decided to take a short rest. Perhaps one of those 10-minute breaks which we all enjoy. As he rested, a Samaritan lady came to the well to collect water. And as she approached to lower her vessel into the water, Jesus asked her to give him a drink. The lady, astounded obviously by his request, said, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask from me a drink, a woman of Samaria?" The lady was certainly well aware of the different cultures, as was Jesus. During their discussion, Jesus used a figure of speech about, "I am the water of life. Whoever drinks this water will never thirst. And the water I give will well up in a spring of eternal life." The lady asked Jesus, when she heard his answer, that she would like this water also in her life. Sadly, she missed the point that Jesus was indicating, that he indeed was a promised Messiah. Again, it was not a direct answer. She would have to decide for herself what she thought about Jesus. And working things out for herself means that perhaps she understood. Physically, she had seen Jesus, but had she really understood him? There's a saying which you may have heard, I hear or I listen, and I forget. I see and I remember. I do and I understand. People who perhaps become teachers, members of the medical professions, and clergy have hands-on experience. So for a teacher, there are those dreading teaching practice in schools. For the medical people, there are periods of training in hospitals. And for the clergy positions, positions are allocated during the training for 6 months or so in various churches. Thus, those people would become aware of what the job entails. For the disciples too, they were sent out, remember, on a mission, so that they would understand what mission work was about, and they returned with more understanding about their ministry and above all about the work with Jesus. However, they, the people with whom Jesus had tried to elicit from them whom they thought he was, did not appreciate his full meaning until, to use a phrase so frequently used by Jesus in John's Gospel, my hour has not yet come. Frequently, John attributes this saying to Jesus. In chapter 2, we read about the events at Cana, at the wedding at Cana of Galilee, and Jesus says to his mother, my hour has not yet come. The message from today's gospel has such a reference to this hour. As we heard, some Greek people wished to see Jesus. After a relay of messages by the disciples, Jesus said, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. We perhaps speak of our hour, when, after much planning for our interview about which we started, we are called upon and offered the appointments. So when for Jesus was his hour? That hour for Jesus was the decisive frame in which he understood and interpreted his daily life and vocation. Jesus could only be seen aright and understood in the light of that hour. It is the hour from which he recoiled, but it is also the consummation of a life lived in obedience to God. Understanding and seeing Jesus lifted up on the cross, all that went before in his work and ministry, providing food and wine, healing and restoring to life, were signs of a reality that was made possible only through his death. As we enter this Passiontide and look at the crucifixion from our standpoint, we perhaps realize that we too may add a little more understanding to the person and love of Jesus. People who saw Jesus had the advantage of seeing him his features, something about which we can only speculate. But we have the advantage of the post-crucifixion and resurrection event, and thus we are able to understand Jesus' ministry and who he is. We may certainly say that Jesus is the Messiah, our Saviour. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you, John, for those words. And after hearing what John has given to us this morning, may we declare our faith in the words of the Creed as we declare our faith in God and in our Messiah and Saviour. And so we say together, as we stand to say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated on the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And so I invite Reverend Graham to lead us in our prayers.
Our prayers today are based on some of the news items from the last week. Heavenly Father, you love the world, and you nurture and treasure all you have made. We pray for our government and for leaders of nations all over the world. We ask for harmony and mutual understanding between nations. We pray for justice and security within nations. Father God, we pray that our government would be generous in handling overseas aid, and we pray for restraint in their apportioning of nuclear weapons all over our nation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, you desire that we should pray for those in authority over us. Today we pray for members of our royal family, and especially for those under the spotlight of publicity. We ask your blessing on our Prime Minister and members of the Cabinet. Give each one wisdom in their responsibilities. Guide them in their thoughts and decision-making about finance, foreign affairs, health, education, defence, policing, and transport. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, you gave up Jesus, your Son, to death, so that we might enjoy a life full of peace and good relationships. We pray today for those who live in fear, and especially for those in fear for their lives. We ask for everyone safety and security. We ask for respect for those who feel scared and angry. We pray that those whose job it is to police our nation would do so with sensitivity and respect. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, as we look around our world, we see so much suffering brought about by human hands. Father, please forgive us, and please heal every land. We ask for the restoration of democracy and godly fear. We pray for freedom for prisoners of conscience. We ask for restraint within nations where people live in fear of their leaders. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for those who work as journalists, bringing us news from every corner of our nation and the world. Please protect them from harm, and please help them as they seek after truth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, you paid the highest price imaginable that we might be yours. Thank you for our church here in Alsager. Please strengthen, guide, and inspire us in all that we do. We give you thanks today for Michelle, for John, for Brian, and for Albert. And we ask you to bless us through them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray today for those who've asked us to pray for them in their particular time of need. We pray for Brian, for Patricia, for Jan, for Derek, for Marion and Harry, for Barbara, for David, Diana, Lizzie and Catherine. We pray too for the families of those who have died recently, remembering with love Giles, RJ, Percival, Irene Moore, Alan Walker, the organist Len Forster, and Anne Smeaton. May they rest in peace and rise in glory. And at their year's mind, we pray for and give thanks for people we have known and loved, remembering especially with love and affection Betsy Hulson, Joseph Gilhooley, Leslie George Woolliscroft, Mike Elkin, June Rose Roseanne, and Stephen Brian Haley. May they rest in peace and rise in glory. A moment of silence for our personal prayers, praying especially for those nearest and dearest to us, and praying for those we know of in great need. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
I invite you to stand as we share together the peace. Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and we share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us share together and with those at home a sign of the peace. Peace with you. While we do so, we listen to the choir of Paisley Abbey, who sing for us, "Be still, my soul."
Thank you.
Jesus, true vine and bread of life, ever giving yourself that the world might live, let us share your death and passion, and make us perfect in your love. Amen. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is indeed right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and eternal God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For as the time of his passion and resurrection draws near, the whole world is called to knowledge in his hidden majesty. The power of the life-giving cross reveals the judgment that has come upon the world and the triumph of Christ crucified. He is the victim who dies no more, the Lamb once slain who lives forever, our advocate in heaven to plead our cause, exalting us there to join with angels and archangels, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread and gave it to them and said, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again, he praised you, gave it to them and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. And so, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross, bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation. We proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Praise to you, Lord Jesus. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with St. Mary Magdalene and all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever. Amen. And so let us say together the prayer which our Saviour Christ has taught us, in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. And together we pray. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs from under your table. But you are the same, Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious body and blood, that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. So we receive in faith the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, given for us. We listen to York Minster Choir, O Thou who at Thy Eucharist did pray. So let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you have taught us that what we do for the least of our brothers and sisters, we do also for you. Give us the will to be the servant of others as you were the servant of all, and gave up your life and died for us, but are alive and reign now and forever. Amen. And together we say, Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Before the blessing, just a couple of words of notices. One, as has already been pointed out, don't forget to do your census today. Today is the date and the deadline. And also don't forget that next Sunday, Palm Sunday, we will still have services at 10:30 a.m. But 10:30 a.m. may be a different time for you if you forget to move your clocks forward. So, the clocks change next Sunday and we get an hour less in bed, but an hour sooner to join us for worship. What more could we ask for? And so one thing we could ask for is some words of blessing. So let us pray. Christ crucified, draw you to himself, to find him in a sure ground for faith, a firm support for hope, and the assurance of sins forgiven, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among us and those whom we love, this day and always. Amen. And some final words of scripture for this season of Passiontide. Is it nothing to you, all you who pass by? Look and see if there is any sorrow like my sorrow. Unless a grain of wheat falls to the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. May I never boast of anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me, and I to the world. Go in the peace of Christ. Thanks be to God. Stand up for Jesus, a choir of Tewkesbury Abbey.